Welcome back, Monday Night Lights 101.7 WDSR after a week off because of the holiday, and we got another day off, so Thanksgiving dinner,
yes.
Ducksgiving was on Monday night, so we decided not to have it. Hope everyone had a wonderful Thanksgiving full of lots of laughs and love.
And football.
And football, of course. Most people weren't feeling the game by 8 o'clock.
Yeah, no.
They were like, who is this guy? Where is he from? Scott Tolzien, former Packer.
Yeah.
Former Wisconsin Badger, I believe.
Yes, Wisconsin.
So now you can say you can name one Wisconsin quarterback that isn't Russell Wilson.
Yes, you can.
Who's more of an NC State quarterback. He transferred one year.
Yeah.
NC State really didn't help him out. But anyway, how was your Thanksgiving, Lewis?
It was delightful. How was yours?
It was pretty good. You know, it was interesting, but had some good food, hung out with some good people.
You know, oh, yeah.
That's what it's all about. I got a lot of crap for not eating stuffing. I don't like stuffing.
Stuffing's, like, at the bottom of my list, too.
Yeah, I don't...
There's too much stuff in it. Like, no pun intended. Like, if I'm looking for a starch, I don't want carrots in it.
Yeah, no, I feel you. Like, I'm... Like, I'll just eat the dinner rolls. That's what I'll eat.
Mashed potatoes. There was mac and cheese at mine.
Like,
There were other options.
I had soup for the first time ever on Thanksgiving.
Really?
Jess's dad made broccoli cheddar soup. Or cream of broccoli.
Were you at Jess's house or Panera?
Hey, man. I was cool with it. The soup was good. I liked it. And then it was sauteed green beans with bacon.
Ooh, that sounds good.
They didn't want to make green bean casserole, so I thanked God there. And I got some, the green beans was good. But other than that, it was just a normal, regular Thanksgiving dinner. But yeah, I get a lot of crap for not eating stuffing. And I feel like a lot of younger people don't eat stuffing.
Yeah.
Is that a millennial thing? I don't.
Maybe.
All right, well. We'll talk about the Eagles-Packers coming up. We'll preview that game right now. Some of the interesting news we got some earlier today. We got some that just broke right before the show started.
Yes.
First, we'll start off with Nelson Agholor, who was thought to be his snaps were going down. Turns out that he is not dressing at all. They're going with four receivers. That's it. I don't know if I like the move necessarily. And I'll explain why, but what do you think about that? Is that Nelson Agholor gets his feelings hurt when he drops balls, but he's now that he's inactive.
Yeah. I mean, I guess it's, you know, you're going to be inactive. I guess maybe it might let a fire under his ass to play harder and actually do what he's paid to do and catch the ball. But at the same time, I think, you know, I think the NFL is going further and further away from needing a true number one, despite what Birch may tell us week in and week out. You know, even the best teams, even, you know, the Giants, you know, the Cowboys, yeah, they have their number one guy, but especially with the Giants, 2 and 3 are right up there with them. You know, and you look at, you know, New England and, you know, I think the need for a true number one is gone as long as you have multiple options. So, I mean, I like it from an aspect of, one, it may light a fire under Agholor to play harder and do his job. But at the same time, it allows him to really... It allows the Eagles, not Agholor, to really get a sense of, you know, like you've been saying since week one, it feels like, play the young guys. Play Paul Turner. Play Bryce Trex. See what we have. And I think this allows them to do it. And especially when you're only carrying four receivers, there's not going to be as much going in and out because there's just not the subs.
Yeah, the reason I don't like it is not because, like, I like what you said where you're keeping the same guys out there. I don't like it because what happens if there's an injury?
Yeah.
I expect it with Agholor being benched that it would be more of a more Burton, more Ertz, and more Sproles in the slot.
Yeah.
That's great. But Sproles is fighting a fractured rib. You saw what happened when Matthews goes over the middle.
Yeah.
I mean, this defense they're playing is depleted. They're going to try and bite on some balls. They're going to try and I mean, I don't want to say they're going to try and take a guy out, but, I mean, if a guy comes across the middle and...
They're getting popped.
Yeah, I mean, you only got four receivers, like...
Especially Green Bay, they're desperate.
Yeah,
I mean... If there's anybody else.
It is a must-win game for both teams. And I just don't like the idea of not having insurance there.
Yeah.
Because it's not, like, you already... I don't know where these roster spots are going.
Yeah.
Because you're already down a running back. You were going to be down... Offensive lineman
with
Vitae. Now you're down two because Brooks was just scratched because he went to the hospital with an illness earlier, and we'll touch on that. I don't know where all these extra roster spots are going because maybe they're just going to be rotating more on defense, try and keep guys fresh for the entire game. But, I mean, you need weapons out there. And right now, unless, like, Barner's getting some snaps in the slot, I just... The injury aspect worries me.
Yeah.
And I guess we'll see. I mean, I'm not saying we should be playing Aguilar. I'm saying he should be there for depth.
Yeah.
So Brandon Brooks out with an illness. That already puts, I believe that'll put in Isaac Salamalu. Yeah, it will. Because Barber had to move to the right tackle, obviously. So Wisniewski had to be in the game. And now.
Is Vitae out?
Yes, Vitae is out. He messed up his knee. I think it was like a MCL sprain or something. I'm not exactly sure. But right now, starting lineup for the... Well, Eagles had changed the starting lineup. Treggs at receiver, Wisniewski left guard, Samalo right guard, Barber right tackle, Sproles at running back. Even though we expected Wendell to be starting at running back, now Sproles is at running back.
Yeah.
This is not good. Well, I don't know if we're going to be able to run to the right side. I mean, it is Isaac's time to shine. He doesn't have a tough opponent to go against. I'm trying to think, who was Vitae's first opponent?
Dallas, right?
Dallas.
Yeah, so.
Okay. And he struggled there. I mean, he's on the inside. He'll be able to get some help, but it's a must-win game, like I said, for both teams, and having these injuries isn't ideal.
Isn't going to help.
Having... The Paul Turner, undrafted free agent rookie, who, I mean, if you were listening to the Sports Radio WIP, if you're on Twitter today, you would think that guy is already the best receiver in Eagles history if you have no idea. I mean, people are calling and saying he's getting 100 yards. I would be happy if he got 4 for 40 tonight. Yep. I mean, that would be awesome. But I think it's you're going to have to rely on the tight ends tonight, especially if Clay's in the inside. If Clay Matthews is in the inside and they don't move him outside, I want Burton... Selleck.
Is Clay Leonard, playing tonight?
I believe he is. I want all three of them all to have at least 5 catches.
Yeah.
And I think if you're able to do that, I think you'll be fine. But it's relying on the young kids. I mean, some you have to, some not so much. But, like, I don't want Turner playing the outside.
Yeah.
He can't do that. He's better in the slot. It'll be interesting to see, and I really, really hope that they can get out on top of Green Bay, because if they get behind, it could just be like what happened with us against Pittsburgh.
Yeah, or Seattle.
Yeah, exactly. I think our defense will play well, but it's on the offense. And I don't like Sproles playing running back. I think Wendell should be there, and I think Sproles should be in the slot because, I mean, he's a mismatch, as well as tight ends will be.
Yeah. So,
what do you think is... Oh, here comes Birch.
Yep.
Let's see. Let's get him on. Hey, you're on Monday Night Lights.
Still connecting.
Oh. Hey, there Birch. He is. You're on Monday Night Lights.
You guys ready for tonight's big game?
It's big.
Go Pack Go.
Yeah.
Go. I hear Go Birds Go, so, you know, that's good.
Yeah, it's going to be
I think you might need your hearing checked then.
No, I mean, you know, it should be an interesting game. I just saw the news about Brandon Brooks being out. So, I mean, you know, that's kind of a big blow. But I guess if there's a silver lining, you know, Green Bay's defense hasn't really been that good. But at the same time, Clay Matthews comes back. So, you know, that's really going to be interesting to see how Barbary sliding over to right tackle and Salamalu moving over to right guard. I'm interested to see how those guys hold up.
I mean, I think right away, if there's runs, they'll be to the left side. I think that you got to get maybe short passing, quick passes for Carson, but I would still put him under center. I'm not sure how the line's going to look. I know that 4 of the 5 can hold their own, but I mean, if you have to start helping Somalo, then I think that's when you can get into some issues. Because I mean, they're going to be pulling him, which is a key in the running game.
Yeah.
I'm kind of looking forward to seeing, you know, like Wendell Smallwood running, and maybe like Tim, you suggested earlier on Twitter, like using Sproles more in the slot, quick passes to get to him. You know, Jordan Matthews booming in the outside. I hope they can try to, you know, get him on quick slants. And you know, they gotta keep getting Zach Ertz involved. You know, it's really the quick passes tonight where I think the Eagles can do a lot of damage, especially with, you know, Green Bay's secondary really hasn't been that great this season. So, you know, to attack them early and often, I think, is where the Eagles can have a lot of success.
Yeah, and I agree with you, but I was talking earlier before he came on about putting Sproles in the slot, and he is actually starting at running back tonight. It just came out, which I don't agree with, but I think we'll see a lot of the tight ends split out wide.
Yeah, I was kind of hoping they would start Smallwood so you get a little look at Wendell Smallwood. But, you know, I'm really excited, too, because I was listening to WIP today, and they gave a stat out that, on average, the Eagles have only allowed an average of 9 points at home. And, you know, Green Bay has not had a running game all season. So I guess, you know, that they're able to sit back in coverage a little bit more, maybe blitz a little bit less. You know, I do think you do have to blitz Rodgers. You got to get to him and hit him and shake him up. But, you know, I mean, like I said, you know, Green Bay really hasn't had the running game, so the Eagles are able to focus on at least one aspect with the pass game.
Yeah, I mean, they got to make him one-dimensional. If you could have Rodgers have – if Rodgers – has a 55% completion percentage, and if he throws for 250 yards and 2 touchdowns, I think you did a great job against him. I mean, that man's lighting the world on fire. I don't care what anyone's saying about, oh, they're Aaron Rodgers taking a step back. No, he's the only reason that they have 4 wins. I think they need to bring pressure and force him to get rid of the ball quick. I think our D-line should own the offensive line without TJ.
Yeah, he's out today. So, yeah. I mean, that especially with him being a guard on Fletcher Cox's side, you got to really hope Fletcher Cox can eat some big Thanksgiving leftovers tonight and get the Rodgers. But, yeah, I mean, you hit the nail on the head. They got to get the Rodgers. They got to force him. As much as it doesn't happen, you got to force him to make mistakes. But, you know, holding him to 250 yards and 2 touchdowns, that's pretty damn good if the Eagles defense can do that.
Yeah, I would be a big fan of that. I think you can stop the run. Chris DeMichael, he's a hard downhill runner, but I don't think they're even going to be able to get any type of push without Lang. I mean, I think our end should own him easily.
Yeah, I mean, look, I've been thinking about it. I mean, I hate to say any game is like a lock in, but you know, it's pretty favored on the Eagles side. And you know, looking forward, I mean, Cincinnati, the Eagles should be able to beat Cincinnati. And then, you know, from there you have 3 home games to 1 road game, 3 home games being the divisional games. You know, it's really going to make things interesting, especially with, you know, Dallas, New York, and Washington all being in playoff contention. So, I'm just excited. I hope that, you know, the receivers can kind of get gelling tonight, rally around Aguilar getting benched. Hopefully they all step up and hold on to the stinking football. We're all getting ready to head in, so I'll leave you guys with final prediction. I'm going to go Eagles 31, Packers 26.
Yeah, I can see that. I think both teams can end up in the 30s. I think it'll be 28-27 Eagles. What do you think? You got a prediction?
You Giants fan.
I will go. I think Rodgers is going to expose the secondary. I'm going 28-21 Pack.
You know, it's funny. You guys get on me for always picking the Eagles, and then here's Lewis. Never will pick the Eagles. Never.
Hey, if I got to pick week one, I would have taken the Eagles.
You know what the problem is? You just don't understand that you need to just trust the process.
I am sick of the process.
Hey, Birch.
You know, if you just, yeah.
Before you go in, I want to ask you something that, and I want you to, because you'll be in there about an hour early. I want you to try and get this to as many Eagles fans as possible. If Paul Turner drops his first pass tonight, please do not boo him.
Oh, no, I mean, you know, and real quick, I'll just throw this in. You know, I thought about it, and I try to be a good person sometimes, as hard as that is. You know, it's fun to kind of throw the memes at Aguilar and everything, but, you know, when it boils down to it, when a guy understands that he's a liability and he's costing this team, I mean, I kind of feel for him. I mean, you know, it's a first-round pick. He's making millions of dollars, but, you know, it's just a shame to hear him in these interviews, knowing that he's really costing this team. You know, look, drops happen. They happen to the best of them. When they happen as often as they have, it's really concerning. I've been saying ever since the Seattle game that they needed to bench him. Just he needs to take a step back. You know, he needs to clear his head. But, you know, yeah, for you, I will definitely pass the word on if Paul Turner drops the ball to go easy on him.
Thank you.
I got my brother texting in, too. He's obligated to say this because his girlfriend's from Philly, but he's saying 35-24 Eagles tonight. They need to produce.
Yeah, they need to produce. They need to just build on this process, this wonderful, beautiful process that they've laid out.
Yeah, I mean, they got to keep moving forward, but I really hope Doug doesn't lay an egg in another primetime game.
Well, yeah, I mean, like, his play calling has just been blah, but, I mean, they're at home. It's going to be lightened up. They're back in black, so, you know, I think they got this one. But, you know, I've seen stranger things happen, and, you know, the Eagles have had trouble with the Packers lately, so... Trust the process.
Just word of advice. Every game's a loss until you win it. I said Cleveland was going to beat us yesterday. So
that's, you know, and that saves you from disappointment. Like Tim
exactly.
Tell me. Save yourself from the disappointment.
Yeah, I mean, hopefully it's a good one. I think it will be. You, of course, enjoy the game. Make sure Paul Turner doesn't get booed.
Turner will leave this game a hero. I just got that sneaky feeling.
Do you have a Paul Turner prediction tonight?
I thought about this on the drive down. I'm going to go Paul Turner 3 catches for 70 yards.
Paul Turner, the deep threat, huh? Wow. All right.
Well, yeah, I think, you know, he's not fast, but he's got pretty good hands. He's pretty good after the catch, so... I got a sneaky feeling he has a pretty good game tonight.
All right, sounds good. I have him at 4 catches for 40 yards, and I thought that was a little crazy. Can't believe I Birch beat with the yardage, but not with the receptions. So.
Live life on the edge. You know what? What do we got to lose? Our receivers are just nothing to write home about. So why not go Paul Turner?
Indeed, and go Eagles. Or as Lewis
and go
says.
Birds, yeah. Yeah. Screw you, Giants fan.
Go Pack
Birds.
Go.
All right, gentlemen, you have a good night.
Yeah, enjoy the game.
And trust the process.
He's getting a lot of hand with the trust the process thing.
When you're calling him out of hand, that's how you know it's out of hand.
Well, the thing I'm going to – this is a little Sixers talk, but the process was over when Hinkie
died.
Yeah. The process died with Hinkie.
Hinkie died for the process.
When you sign veterans, yeah, and you trade Jeremy Grant for a veteran, that's not the process. The process was dead when Hinkie was dead.
Yep.
But that's just my little Sixers thing.
Sixers don't get in often, so we might as well throw them in when we can.
I was just – because everyone is like, oh, yeah, I trust the process. But this isn't the process. The process is over. The process is when we had Casper Ware as guard, and we had – or John Lucas III or Tim Frazier. Or,
Michael Carter-Williams.
Or AK-47.
AK-47.
So, I mean
– I think AK-47 was the oldest you guys got before Elton Brand last year.
we had – we definitely – oh, we – who did we buy out? put out a lot of guys. We bought out JaVale McGee. That was after AK-47. We bought out Gerald Wallace. I think Gerald Wallace might have been our first buyout.
Yeah.
Good old Gerald Wallace. He leads like every single category in Hornets history.
Yeah.
It's phenomenal. But I'm trying to actually find Paul Turner's preseason stats and see, because I think Birch's his prediction is way too out there. I don't think he's going to be able to get 70 yards on only three catches.
No. I got him for maybe 5 for 50.
Yeah, I mean,
just because of the lack of depth, he'll get he'll play a lot of snaps.
10 yards, I can see. I really cannot see him being able to do anything like that. Oh man, preseason stats. Where could I even find them? I'll have to look during break, but. I mean, yeah. I mean, if you were saying like Bryce Treggs was getting that,
yeah,
I'd have been like, all right, I can dig that. But this
see him, I could see potential. Is he active for today?
Treggs?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's starting receiver.
Yeah, oh, so he him I could see him going over 100 yards today because of his speed.
All right, so Turner had 17 receptions. For 165 yards, it's 9.7 average.
So he's a possession guy.
He's your Jason Avant.
Yeah.
I mean, he's going to be the guy that has pretty good hands. Jason Avant had awesome hands.
Yeah.
And he's going to be there on that one. What?
I learned that one.
Yeah, yeah, he's awesome. I have my Kelsey jersey on now. I should have brought my Jason Avant, former TO jersey. I have Avant just taped over Owens. But, yeah, I mean, Paul Turner is your third down safety blanket. I don't think he'll be anything more than that in his career if he becomes anything at all.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just how it is. I like him. I hope the best for him. But
yeah, I mean, if anything, Riley Cooper's still out there on free agency.
Oh, yeah.
Just bring him right on back on in.
But one thing I want to talk about is the fact of...
And my brother's going even lower. He's saying 2 catches for 15 yards.
Hey, you know what? That's a safe bet right there. I mean, it's not a guy you would pick up in fantasy, but that is a very,
very safe
bet.
No, he would because he'd go heavy on Rodgers and Wentz.
But I want to ask this question right now because you're seeing it from a different perspective.
Yeah.
For the most part, you don't like either team, the Packers or the Eagles, because they are both in your way. One in the division, one overall in the NFC. I was thinking about this today, looking at both teams, and it might sound crazy on the surface when I ask this, but which team has the better future? And I know it could be, well, the Eagles have all these young players, but the Packers still have the franchise quarterback. They still have young receivers. They still have some good pieces. Is it just the injuries that stopped them this year? Do they just need to start retooling with some young players? Can they do that? Are the Eagles going in the right spot with their young players, with a little older defense, not by much, but and a young coach? Would you rather have basically a future of all young guys and a good defense, or franchise quarterback and a coach that's been there?
This is a tough question. I'm going to go with the Eagles. Only because of the philosophy of the team. If the Packers had Howie Roseman in charge, then absolutely the Packers. But I think the stubbornness from the Packers front office to go out and get guys to complement what they already have. Yeah, they've brought in Cook. He's been all right. You know, they brought in Peppers last year. He was good last year, not so much this year. You know, I think their stubbornness to add to what they have in the long term through free agency, not just drafting them and developing them up. Their stubbornness to make a move to complement the team in a free agency situation or a trade, I think is going to hold them back long term. And I mean, it's the reason why Favre only won one, as good as Favre was. So I think, you know, with the Eagles situation, I mean, they need a running back. You know, I think Wendell could be, you know, a nice backup long term. You know, obviously a receiver needs to get sorted out. But at the same time, you know, with Roseman in charge, there's there's not the stubbornness to make a move on an Alshon Jeffrey, on a Terrell Pryor, on a, you know, somebody. There's not that stubbornness to make, to not make a move because we want to develop them and bring them up through our system like Green Bay does. So with that said, I would go the Eagles just because of the way the teams run.
So you think that the Packers should have made a run at a guy like Janoris Jenkins, a guy like Vernon, or even a guy like Snacks, all the guys that the Giants ended up getting. And you see, now see, it's funny because I was critical of the Giants and their signings because I didn't think, I mean, the dream team is really...
It still haunts you.
Yeah, it haunts me, and it really hurts me when I look at free agent signings, and especially three big ones on the defense. Didn't really do anything at linebacker. I think they brought in Kennard from Washington, right? Or who was the Washington?
Keenan Robinson.
He was the Washington linebacker.
And Shepard's been good, too, that we picked up.
So, I mean, I looked at the defense, and I was like, well, they just kind of used big contracts to try and fill many holes.
Mm-hmm.
However, it's kind of worked. The offense has been very good. The defense has also been – I mean, the defense has been fair. It's not been great. I think, like you said, I think the Packers should have done that eventually because coming into the season, you say, oh, they're just decimated with injuries. Their secondary was not good coming into the season. Sham Shields, very good. Other than that, no one. I mean, they moved.
Lost Casey Hayward.
Yeah. I mean, they had to move Matthews inside because they just didn't have any linebackers.
Exactly. It seems like they have Rodgers, Nelson, Cobb, Matthews. Then what?
Mm-hmm.
Clinton Dix has shown flashes, but is he going to give you enough to be, you know, is he going to be a solid safety, or is he going to be, you know, a Kenny Vaccaro who kind of has a couple good years to start his career and then dies out?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and they start playing guys like, you know, Jake Martinez, I think his name is. I think he's a rookie.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I get it. You want to draft your guys and bring them up in your system. But at the same time, they had just as good of a chance as anybody to sign, like you said, the three Giants signings. Or hell, even a veteran. Chris Long, Nick Fairley, Laurinaitis. Any of these guys could have helped out their defense, and the only move they made this offseason was to bring in Jared Cook.
So. Yeah, and I think that definitely has hurt them. They weren't prepared for injuries. They weren't prepared for what this season has brought, which, I mean, really they're stuck out trying to outscore guys.
Yeah.
And they're just not the Saints at doing that.
No.
One question before we go to break. We'll come back. We'll talk the rest of the NFL. You mentioned Clinton Dix, and I always thought him and Landon Collins were kind of the same type of player. Do you think if you would have brought in a Janoris Jenkins or a big-time corner, a good corner...
To Green Bay.
To Green Bay, you think that it would have helped out Clinton Dix as it has helped out Collins? Because it's kind of taken the pressure off of Collins because he knows, all right, for the most part, Jenkins has got that side locked down.
I don't know. I think it could. But at the same time, I think Clinton Dix really evolved his game when he got to the NFL. He was kind of the ball hawk to Collins being in the box when they were at Bama. And now he's kind of moved into the box, too, where he started before Collins started playing at Alabama. So, you know, I could see it. I could see him, you know, having the success that Collins is having because he has shown it. He showed it earlier than Collins did. He was good his rookie year as opposed to Collins, who was god-awful. But I think, you know, the Giants this year, and here's where I'll balance it out. The Giants this year got back to what won them the two Super Bowls, and it's, you know, we get sacks because we have a good defense. For a while there, when we had Amukamara, Roll, DRC. You know, we had one pass rusher. And it was a matter of, we're going to try to lock you down long enough so that way, you know, our, with the exception of Pierre Paul, our subpar defensive linemen can try to get to the quarterback. And the defensive line was just never good enough to do that. Like I said, aside from Pierre Paul, but when you start drawing double and triple teams because you don't have any threats next to you, doesn't help. So, with that said, to build up your question, I think Jenkins, he's good. He isn't a lockdown guy like a Norman or, you know, Sherman or Peterson, but Green Bay just doesn't have the defensive line to do with the Giants. If we were talking, like I said, Josh Norman, who, again, another one, they had just as much of an opportunity to sign him as the Redskins did, then maybe different story, and I think it would. You know, Collins able to play off of Norman, I think it would work because he's that lockdown type of corner. But I think Jenkins, not so much, because Green Bay just doesn't have the line.
So you think a D-line would help out Clinton Dix more than a corner? Gotcha. We'll be right back on Monday Night Lights, 101.7 WDSR. We'll be back with the NFL, and I'm going to talk about how probably the most talked about quarterback for not quarterbacking is back. That was a mouthful, wasn't it?
A lot of quarterbacks.
Yeah, it's Christmas music time, so we'll leave you with Wonderful Christmas Time by Paul McCartney. Get in the spirit, fellas. We'll be right back on Monday Night Lights, 101.7 WDSR.
The spirit's up, we're here tonight, and that's enough. Simply having a wonderful Christmas time. Simply having a wonderful Christmas time. The party's on, the feeling's here, that only comes this time of year. Simply having a wonderful Christmas time. Simply having a wonderful Christmas time. The choir of children sing their song. Simply having a wonderful
Highlights 101.7 WDSR. We are back. We're going to talk some more NFL as the Eagles game is now 1 hour away. Not really much to touch on there other than it's a must-win game for both teams. Eagles down a receiver because of Aguilar have to rely on Sproles and the tight ends out wide, even though they're starting Sproles. Depleted offensive line. Yep. Packers, terrible defense. One of the best quarterbacks in the league. You got all that?
Yes.
If you're writing it down, I apologize if I went too fast. But as I said before break, we're going to talk about probably the most resurgent player in the NFL, possibly the comeback player of the year. And I know it is only a certain sample size.
Yeah.
But Colin Kaepernick has played very, very well recently. I don't care about his off-the-field stuff. You can think whatever you want to think about that. Doesn't matter to me. It may affect him getting a job this offseason if he does opt out.
Yeah.
But just looking on the field, I watched a little of the game yesterday against the Dolphins, and he played pretty well against the Patriots. I mean, you know he's not going to be the most accurate guy out there.
Yeah, but he never was.
No. I mean, he's at a 55% clip right now. Interception, 3 touchdowns yesterday. I mean, he's using his legs to get out of bad throws.
Yeah.
And I think that's what – I mean, after the Harbaugh era, they kind of tried to – or towards the end of it, they tried to get him out of it. And then Jim Tom Sula came in. It was more of like, all right, whatever you want to do on offense. And then he really got out of running the ball.
Yeah.
But coming back, 100 yards on the ground. I think it was like close to 300 in the air. 3 touchdowns, like I said, 1 interception. I picked him in DraftKings. He was $5,000. Got me 39 points, second to Drew Brees. We saw what Brock Osweiler got in free agency, and seeing what Kaepernick can do here, if he keeps it up, I mean, do the 49ers keep him, or do they go? I mean, they're going to have a top pick.
Yeah.
Or is he going to be the hottest name out there on free agency? Him, like this free agent quarterback class, both in the draft and in free agency, may have some pretty interesting names out there.
Yeah.
It'll be most likely Kaepernick because he'll opt out. $7 million for a quarterback. If he has a resurgence, someone will pay him. Mike Glennon, who I think could be a good starting quarterback in the league. There's some good names out there.
Kirk Cousins, if he doesn't get tagged again.
If the Vikings decide to stick with Bridgewater and get rid of Bradford after the 1 year, which the Eagles did in the contract to set up. I mean, I think it might have been – could be a smart move for them because he really hasn't done anything recently.
Yeah.
What do you see for Kaepernick? Do you think he should stay in San Francisco?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think – I mean, he doesn't have to look too much further from the quarterback that came before him in San Fran, Alex Smith. I mean, Alex Smith went through, 6 offensive coordinators in 6 years? And it screwed him up. And then Harbaugh got there and kind of settled the waters, and he was fine. And I think the same could be said for Kaepernick. I think, you know, Harbaugh, quarterback friendly. He just knows something that everybody else other than Bruce Arians doesn't know. And obviously, Tom Sula was a joke. But I think as long as Chip's there, you know, and I'm not sure who his old coordinator is, but for the most part, as long as Chip's there, stay in San Fran. Because all that's going to happen is you're going to go to, you know, where? The Jets, Denver, Chicago. You're going to have to pick up a whole new system, and you're going to be back at square one. If I'm Colin Kaepernick, you might as well stay where you're comfortable and stay in San Fran. And if anything, like you said, they're going to have a top pick. I mean, they have 1 win, so to Cleveland's none. So they're going to have a, you know, number 2, number 3 pick. If this trend continues, and I know they've you know, the 49ers have bet all their chips on this guy before, and it backfired. But you want to know something? If he has a resurgence, sign him. I'm sold on Deshaun Watson. I'm not sold on Deshaun Kizer yet. So, that's where I'm at. They can easily get more, I would say, than the Browns got from you guys to get wins. Purely because you're looking at a, you know, FBS quarterback from Notre Dame, big time school, as opposed to North Dakota State. Granted, Wentz had all the measurables that panned out and he looked good. But San Francisco may be able to get more for their number two pick than Cleveland got from the Eagles last year. And you want to know something? If he has a resurgence and you can drop down to, you know, 5, 6, 7 and grab a Fournette to go with Carlos Hyde, or, you know, drop down further, get a Juju Smith, you know, I think if he has a resurgence, keep him. Because if anything, his tenure in Philadelphia showed that not every quarterback can run Chip's system. And if Kaepernick has a resurgence, bet on him again.
Now, if he opts out, you think they're not going to want to pay him what someone else could pay him, you think? They're kind of sour towards Kaepernick.
Yeah.
Right? So the only reason they keep him is if he opts
in. But if they didn't want him, they could have cut him.
True.
Because of his off-field stuff, they could have cut him in camp when it first started. And I think the price, is it going to be more than $7 million? Absolutely, considering Chase Daniel, who hasn't played a snap in his life, gets 10 from you guys.
The cap hits not 10, but
well, that's he's going to get more than 7. But there's a limited market of teams that are going to be looking for a quarterback this offseason anyway. And when you take into account that there's Romo, Cousins, Cutler.
Possibly. Yeah.
Possibly.
Foles.
Foles.
Keenum. Keenum. Who have started in the
season
before. EJ Manuel, Brian Hoyer.
Yeah. Glennon.
Mallett.
Mallett. Well, he's...
True.
Ship sailed on him. But
the reason I put out so many names, and I don't mean to cut you off, is the fact that, like you were saying earlier with Kizer, who is the most pro... what pro-ready quarterbacks are coming out of college?
The Deshauns.
I wouldn't even say Kizer. If I was him, I'd stay in because... No, not because I want Notre Dame to actually have a winning season next year. I do. But, I mean, his accuracy, his decision-making, very, very raw. And they're not playing great defenses. I mean, look at who they played this year. Not playing great defenses. Yeah. I think that he is a little overhyped right now. I think Deshaun Watson has his flaws as well, but I think he is the most pro-ready out of all of them. I think Brad Kaya has the same problems as Kizer, maybe not. They might be a little less, but his arm strength is also a little less.
Yeah.
I mean, I think you could see a lot of backups or guys that have started with a little upside in them. I think they could really be getting some starting jobs next year.
Yeah. And I mean, like you said, there's a lot of quarterbacks out there. I mean, when you start talking that Mike Glennon can get a starting job somewhere, there's just a lot of options.
Romo will be out there.
Romo. Like I said, Romo, Cousins, Glennon, Cutler. Hell, if someone wants to give Fitzpatrick or Geno Smith a chance, there's going to be a lot of guys out there on free agency. That, tied with his off-field issue, not issues, but what comes along with him off the field, and the stances he takes and the things he says, not every team is going to be open to bringing him in. And I feel bad for the guy. He hasn't done anything wrong. But he's going to have limited interest because of it. And granted, that's coupled with the fact that he signed a long extension and then fell off a cliff. But I think the amount of teams that are going to be interested in him is going to be lower because of his what comes along with him. And at the same time, any team that could be interested in him could also just as easily go for Mike Glennon, who hasn't started in 2 years. So, you know, if I'm the Bears, okay, Watson goes one. Let's just say someone trades up, not the Bears, to get Kaiser at two. Kaya isn't worth a top five pick. You got to look at it and, you know, Glennon for, you know, 10, 12 mil, who doesn't come along with anything, or Kaepernick for 15, 17 mil because he starts and everything that comes with him. You know, and I think it's going to weigh his market down a bit to where there's not going to be as many teams bidding on him like we saw with Osweiler.
Yeah, and I think I'm going to run through the teams now that will be looking for a quarterback, whether to start or back up, because backups are very important in the league.
Yes.
I think the Cowboys will get rid of Romo. They will need a backup.
Yeah.
Giants need a backup. Nassib's going to walk.
Yeah.
Manning's getting up there in age. I mean, I know he has that great streak going, but eventually something's going to happen.
Yeah.
I mean, you saw what happened to Peyton.
Yeah.
Redskins, depending on what happens to Cousins.
Yeah.
Probably Bears are getting rid of Cutler. Vikings, if they go away from Bradford and want a guy that
could still bring in a vet for a year,
yes.
Yeah.
And that could kind of start the first couple games depending on how Bridgewater comes back, or a good insurance policy that they're not paying 18 mil or whatever Bradford's getting paid.
Yeah.
I'd probably say I think the Rams will probably bring someone in. Behind, I
back up Goff.
I like Sean Mannion, but you need a veteran in there.
Yeah,
and right now he's not really getting anything from the quarterbacks in that room.
Yeah,
the 49ers, they'll probably draft Watson. Kaepernick will probably go. I just feel like that the tension's there. It's crazy, but I mean, if they're willing to pay him, I think you'll get a top quarterback, and you'll probably get a veteran. Or Kaepernick.
Yeah.
The Bills probably would get a
Cardinals could.
Cardinals will probably bring in a guy. I wouldn't be surprised if they bring in a guy like Glennon.
Yeah.
He's going to be a name out there, but bring him in, let him sit for Palmer for a year.
Yeah.
Let him just soak up Arians and Palmer, and I would keep Stanton on the roster at that point because I don't even think you're paying him anything. The Chargers, depending on what happens with Rivers, I mean, it seems like every year they're talking about getting rid of him. But at the same time, he's getting up there in age.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised if the Chiefs start looking for a quarterback.
Yeah.
I mean, Alex Smith is getting up there. He's serviceable. But, I mean, eventually you'd want some more playmaking ability out of your offense.
Oh, yeah.
Jaguars, I really don't like Bortles. I think he's starting to go down a little. He's got a really bad release, and they're just not winning games. I think the pressure is going to be on them. Browns, obviously.
Jets. Oh, but I think the Browns draft Watson.
Oh, yeah, no doubt. But I think they're going to bring – I mean, either they keep McCown or they bring someone in.
Yeah.
I'd say Jets. I mean, they've refused to go to Petty. Hackenberg obviously isn't ready. I mean, Fitzpatrick's probably going to walk.
Yeah.
I mean – unless they want to roll with Petty this year, even though they don't want to do it when their season's over, let alone when their season starts next year 0-0.
Yeah.
I'd say a lot of teams are going to be looking for either a backup because, like the Bills, they got Tyrod Taylor running all the time, fragile guy. You're going to need someone to back him up as Manuel's gotten a good amount of time with them. Or you're going to have to look for a starter. like the 49ers or the Browns, depending on who they bring in, if they're going to sit them. You know, it's Bears.
And obviously another one, and they were talking about this last night, another one that's interesting that could really shake up the market is Simeon.
Yeah.
If they decide to go to Lynch and either trade or release Simeon.
True. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised the Broncos do what they did last year, have three quarterbacks competing for one job.
Yeah.
And then you keep two and you cut one. Because at this point, I Simeon's having a decent year, but...
Remember what they said. They were like, you know, I forget what year it exactly was, but, I mean, you had... Elway's done this before. You had Tim Tebow take the world by storm and win games and win a playoff game and then sign Peyton Manning.
Yeah, I mean, obviously there's no one out there like Peyton Manning.
I mean,
Tony Romo is probably our most high-profile guy out there. I would say Cousins, but could probably get Romo for cheaper.
Oh, yeah.
And most likely Cousins will be franchised.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, yeah, I mean, the Broncos... They're not having a bad year. Simeon's not having a bad year. 15 touchdowns, 7 interceptions, 60% completion percentage.
It's a lot better than Osweiler's doing.
Yeah, no doubt. And they're paying him much, much less. But at the same time, it's like, all right, we just won it all. We won the Lombardo Trophy. We got to do something right now. Our running game's not doing anything. It's all the pressure getting put on the defense. If we miss the playoffs... Yeah, we may go 10-6 and miss the playoffs, but come on now. How long is this defense going to be elite?
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, guys are getting up there in age. You're going to have to start losing guys because you got to pay guys. So, I mean, you may. I wouldn't be surprised to see a Romo there for 2 years, something like that. But yeah, I think a lot more teams.
Cutler reunion.
I mean, I don't think that, but. I do think a lot of teams are going to be on the quarterback market more than we think.
Yeah.
I mean, if a name like Phillip Rivers goes out there, I think a lot of teams are going to say, all right, I think we're willing to make the move where we don't have to rely on our guy.
Yeah.
Anymore. Like, I always thought the Chiefs were a sneaky team if Rivers goes on the block.
If Rivers ever hit, yeah.
I mean.
Well, either of them. I mean, if. San Diego cuts him, there's going to be bad blood.
Oh, I mean, if San Diego cuts him, I mean, I almost guarantee it's Chiefs.
Chiefs or the Broncos, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, if they're going to trade him, I think you can...
Until 2 years ago, I could have said the Raiders, too.
Yeah, true. A lot of teams are going to be out there. I think we're going to see a lot of longtime backups or guys that have had some starts but didn't seem to show it when they were younger, have been sitting for a while. I think a lot of those guys are going to have the chance because... Like I said, Watson, Kaiser, Kaya, none of those guys are impressing me or I don't think will impress right away.
Yeah.
Key point there. I think they're very good players. I think they could turn into very good NFL quarterbacks. But, I mean, unless you're putting them behind Dallas's offensive line and giving them Ezekiel Elliott, it's really not going to work as well as you think it will. So I think Watson's the only one that's pro-ready. We only got 6 minutes left in this segment. I want to touch on just some of the things that happened this past week. Are the Raiders a legit contender? I mean, they don't seem dominant in most games like I would want a contender to. What do you make of them? Is that just that way of playing? I'm trying to think of a team that did anything like that and was able to win it. They've kept every game close. I mean, if you don't have Carr with ice in his veins, you could be, 4-4, 5-5. That actually makes sense because there's been 11 games played, or 5-6, or 6-5. So, are they legit? That's really the question I'm asking.
Yeah. I don't know, really. The problem is that I need to see them play the gold standard in the AFC before I'm ready to crown them anything. I really believe that they have all the talent and, you know, building off what I said in the last segment, I think Reggie McKenzie saw what went downhill in Green Bay and is now trying to prevent that in Oakland by adding guys like Bruce Irvin, adding to the offensive line. But I think they have all the pieces in place. I mean, Carr, Cooper, Crabtree. They have all the pieces in place to kind of be that new AFC powerhouse. Because it's certain that Indianapolis isn't getting there because, like the Packers, they refuse to build it on Andrew Luck. So I do. I truly believe that they could be the cream of the crop in the AFC for the next 5, 6, 7, 8 years. But before I jump on the bandwagon fully, I need to see them play New England.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at their...
How many teams have we seen look so promising, be it in a playoff game or in the regular season, that it's like, you know, wow, this team really has a chance, and then they go and get buzzsawed by New England.
Yeah, and the thing is, I don't even... I look at other teams in that will make the playoffs, and you say, oh, can they beat New England? Yeah. Well, can they even get to New England?
Yeah.
Because I love the offense. I think their offense is phenomenal. But when you face a good defense in the postseason,
yeah,
you yourself don't have a good defense. I mean, you saw what the Chiefs did to them, beat them 26-10.
Yeah.
I mean,
and that was without Houston.
Exactly. I think a team like Kansas City could stop them. I think a team like Baltimore could stop them if they do make the playoffs. I think their defense is extremely underrated.
Yes.
You look at,
as is their special teams,
yeah,
holding.
I would say a team like really the Texans, but I don't think they have enough offensive firepower. I don't think their offense is there.
Yeah, not
but
this year.
I mean, you could see where a defense like some of these teams have could really shut them down a little. I would even say I think Miami has a pretty good defense, very underrated. I don't know if it's as good. It's not as good as the Chiefs. I don't think it's as good as the Ravens. But I mean, if teams with good defenses make the playoffs and run into the Raiders early, I think you could see them knocked out even before they get a chance to face the Patriots.
Yeah.
I mean,
and they get penalized way too often.
Exactly. If you're gonna face a team that has a good defense and you're getting how many penalties a game?
To
20?
Not to cut you off, it reminds me of what we've seen the last 4 or 5 years in Cincinnati.
Oh, yeah.
They could
put
up all the points in the world when they had, obviously, when they had Sanu and Jones to go with Green. Not so much this year. But you had, and their penalties were on the defensive side. You had Pac-Man and Burfitt, and it was penalties all over the place. And sure, they got through the regular season, but the second they played a playoff, you know, a playoff team, because they're in the playoffs, they fell apart.
Yeah, and I think they can beat a good amount of the playoff teams, but if you get a good defense against them, that could really mess things up for you. And I think Kansas City is that team.
Yeah.
I believe they still face Kansas City.
I think they have them one more time.
Yeah, and they only put up 10 points against them. Every other game has been close. I mean, you got Bills, Chiefs, Chargers, Colts, Broncos, and the way the Raiders are going, like they were, it was a close game against the Chargers the first time.
Yeah.
Lost to Chiefs the first time. The Broncos game, it was a 10-point game. I mean, who knows at this point?
Yeah.
What's going to happen? I think they're a good team. I think they'll make the playoffs. I think Jack Del Rio will win Coach of the Year because I picked that. So I like to
Black
be right.
Jack Del Rio.
But I mean, like I said, run into a good defense. That could be the issue.
Yeah.
I think that needs to shore up. If I see the defense playing better towards the end of the year, then I'm on board. Before we go to break, one thing I want to mention is that Colin Kaepernick, we said, could possibly win Comeback Player of the Year. The only problem is I was looking at who else was up for the award. We both picked players. You had Luck, and I had Kelvin Benjamin. I think it'll be tough to overcome Luck. I mean, do they do it for each division? Or, I mean, each conference?
I think they do.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, I mean, he might have a chance in the NFC. But, yeah, looking at some of the players that are coming back. I mean, he has.
I think
he has played very well, though.
It's going to be tough in the NFC too. I think, not to be a homer, but Jason Pierre-Paul. I think the other half of his hand is regenerated because he's having a monster year this year.
Hey, I mean, possibly the two most stupidest players in the NFL. One with actions and words and not voting.
One with
and
fireworks.
And the other one with fireworks. They're both up for the award. We're going to take a break right now. We're going to come back. We're going to talk NCAA football playoff. Me and Lewis got in a little bit of a argument last week. It's not going to change this week. I mean, this dude is extremely biased. That's just how it is. There's a possible.
You lost to a team who fired their coach.
That's all right. It's all right. So it wasn't our year. But there is a possibility of possibly three Big Ten teams. Lewis told me that scenario earlier. I think there's only one. I'll tell you who I think's in the playoff. Lewis will tell you who he thinks is in the playoff. We'll be right back on Monday Night Lights 101.7 WDSR. Monday Night Lights 101.7 WDSR. Some Chuck Berry. We're getting into some good Christmas music. I have a I have a list of Christmas songs, and it's only 22 songs long.
Yeah.
Because there's not many. Some
there's
of them,
not many. You can't put the same song. Like, you have to put the best version of a particular song.
I like, there's a lot of Christmas songs that are, like, really slow.
Yeah.
A lot of Sinatra, a lot of Andy Williams, a lot of Nat King Cole. And I'm like, you know what? Like, I'm supposed to be happy. Let's, like let's get it going. Like Paul McCartney, John Lennon, Elton John. I mean, they have some good songs. Band-Aid, they have a great song. That's the whole thing about raising money for Africa. It's like Bono's main thing.
Yeah.
Bono loves that. But, I mean, Feliz Navidad, great song. Just really, like, I'm pumped up for Christmas. I want to be pumped up. I don't want to, like...
go to bed.
Yeah. J-I-N-G-L-E, bells. Like, all right, Frank. Like, I love Sinatra, but, like... Let's get hype, you know. But that's neither here nor there. I'm not going to complain about Christmas music at this point. Let's talk about the NCAA playoff.
Yes.
I'm coughing, and now I have the hiccups. It's terrible.
or are you choking like Notre Dame?
We didn't even...
Good enough to choke.
Yeah, I mean, at that point. I mean, we didn't lose to Penn State and possibly our playoffs.
Oh, my God.
And we have the top four teams in the AP poll currently are Alabama, Ohio State, Clemson, Washington. Alabama, no losses. Ohio State, not the Big Ten champion, with one loss. Clemson with one loss, and Michigan with one, or Washington with one loss, excuse me. We keep going back and forth on who is in the playoff. I'm going to go first because people already know one of your teams most likely. I think Alabama is the best team in the country. I think they beat Florida easily. Florida doesn't even have their starting quarterback, Luke Del Rio. I don't think he will be back by the game, but I am not totally sure. And even if he is, Alabama wins that game. I think Clemson will win. They are playing, you told me before,
V-Tech.
Virginia Tech, who was losing by 28 points to Notre Dame, and then Notre Dame blew that. So that was, that was fun, but I don't see Clemson doing that. Washington will be facing Colorado. Colorado's a very young and exciting team with a very good defense, but, I mean, Washington's offense is going to be too much. I believe in Chris Peterson, and I think he'll get to the playoff for the BCS title game, because he was in that era as well, for the first time in his career, and I'm excited. I think he can make some noise. Always liked him as a coach. Maybe we'll get a purple field at Washington instead of a blue field at Boise. And my fourth team is a Big Ten team. It's not Ohio State. It'll be the Big Ten champion, the Wisconsin Badgers. That's my top four. In that order, it'll be Alabama, Clemson, Washington, Wisconsin.
Okay.
Lewis, let's hear some knowledge.
Okay. Alabama won. Best team in the country. Play Florida. Two, Clemson. Three, Ohio State. Four, Big Ten champion Penn State.
So, wait, where did you have Ohio State again? Three?
Three.
Well, why? Then you see Washington getting the boot.
Yes.
Why is that?
I don't think the Pac-12 was strong enough this year. And I think the Big Ten has been looked at very kindly by the voting, by the voters so far this season. Obviously, you know, this until we get the new one Tuesday, we had, you know, the Big Ten had five teams in the top 10. So, you know, it's, they've looked kindly on the Big Ten all season, and I just, you know, their one loss comes on a blocked field goal. Should the game have come down to a blocked field goal? Absolutely not. We played like garbage against Penn State. But it comes down to the question of the best four teams in the country. SEC is a powerhouse conference. Their champion gets in. Big Ten is a powerhouse conference. Their champion gets in. Clemson, all the talent in the world, their champion gets in. Or they win the ACC, they get in. Can you make the case that Washington, even if they win their conference championship, better than Ohio State? And I don't think you can make that argument.
All right, so the Big Ten has Ohio State, Penn State, Michigan, Wisconsin, and is Nebraska ranked?
They may have been at a point.
Nebraska is ranked. Iowa is also ranked. They went from not ranked to ranked. Okay, so that's six, right? Did I count that right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six ranked teams. You got three in the top 10, or four in the top 10, and two in the 20s.
Yes.
Okay. Pac-12 has Washington. Is Washington State ranked? They were.
They were when they played Washington.
All right, Washington State got bumped out because Washington beat them. So that's one. Then you have Colorado, USC. Utah dropped out because they lost to Colorado. And Stanford is ranked. And you have two in the top 10. And one is 17. What was the other team? There's another one? Where's the other Pac-12 team? Did I have four?
Yeah, you had four. It was Washington, Colorado, USC, and Stanford.
Oh, USC's 10. So three in the top 10, one at 17. Two just dropped out. I mean, I think the divisions are pretty even.
That's the tough part with the playoff, is that Ohio State didn't play Washington. But if, what was I going to say? If I think it comes down to, we're comparing, you know, resume versus a conference title, and you know, I'm kind of looking at it like they do with the college basketball bracket, where, you know, you get the lower conference. Not that the Pac-12 is the Sun Belt by any means, but you get, you know, a couple ACC teams that are ranked in the play in the bracket higher than, you know, the Sun Belt champion. And I think looking at the resume, beat Michigan, beat Wisconsin, beat Oklahoma, I think they have a stronger resume than Washington.
Now, see, I don't...
And I think the Big Ten was enough of a gauntlet that whatever team comes out of it...
So, losing by four, or winning by four against Northwestern and winning by one because Michigan State had nothing to lose and went for two, that's running a gauntlet right there.
All right, the bottom is very low. But, I mean...
You beat Indiana. How's Indiana doing?
They're ready for basketball season.
Their quarterback just retired because his brain's more important than his body. He doesn't want his brain to deteriorate playing football, but if he was good at football, he'd probably still be playing. You beat Rutgers. Who's Rutgers' head coach?
Who knows?
Exactly.
Our old coordinator.
But it's all right. You guys played two very tough opponents in the beginning of the season. Because you wanted your non-conference schedule to look good. You beat Bowling Green and Tulsa.
We also beat Oklahoma.
That's fine. But, I mean, you look at who... I mean, you would want to compare ranked teams. You and Washington are right next to each other in ranked teams that they played. But one's a conference champion.
Okay. Who's better, Michigan or USC?
I don't know. They haven't played each other. I mean, that's I'm just using your logic, man, aren't I?
The top of
but
the Big Ten
who's
is
better, Penn State or USC? Because both teams beat, but like Penn State beat Ohio State,
yeah,
and USC beat Washington. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I think a lot of this, we look at the rankings.
We got Mike calling in here, too. He'll
oh,
talk
there it is.
College
here we go. Hey, you're on Monday Night Lights.
Hey, guys. What's going on?
How are you, man? I hear you're on the Penn State bandwagon.
I am on the Penn State bandwagon.
There we go. We got it. I'm not really.
You've been ready for basketball season since week three, so.
Yeah. And I don't really have a Big Ten team, obviously from Pennsylvania, Philadelphia. But I think Wisconsin would win. That's just too. So I'll be on Wisconsin's bandwagon. We'll get a Penn Stater in here, and we got Ohio State. And most likely only one of us is going to make the playoff, and I don't think it's Ohio State. I want to get your take on it, Mike. Do you think there's...
What was that one more time? I lost connect. I was having tough connection on that one.
I was just stating what team we're each rooting for at this point. I don't really have a horse in the race, but I'll take Wisconsin. You have Penn State, and Lewis obviously has Ohio State. Do you see two Big Ten teams making it? Are you with Lewis
Absolutely.
On this one? You do. All right. It must be. Absolutely. Must run in the
Schaefer. I've influenced him well.
Must run the Schaefer household.
I agree with Lewis on the fact that he said there will be the two Big Ten teams will be Ohio State and whoever wins the game on December 3rd. Obviously, as a Penn State fan, I say it's going to be Penn State solely because
you
of the
became
whole,
a Penn State fan this season.
Because I was a Florida fan when I was 12, Lewis. But I think just the role that Penn State's been on. Wisconsin has been a good team all season, but they haven't really done – they're not really that big kind of team that can get into the – because the Big Ten champion is going to be in the playoff. I think at the end of the day, Washington's going to be dropped out win, lose, or draw against Colorado just because of the weakness of the Pac-12 and the fact that – if Penn State wins that Big Ten game, they got ahead of two of the best teams in the country in Ohio State and Michigan to get into that game.
See, I don't think Washington's out if Wisconsin wins, though.
If Wisconsin wins, I'd see I wouldn't disagree with Washington being in the playoff if Wisconsin were to win the Big Ten. But if it were to be Penn State, would you still put Washington in the playoff?
I said it, no. But yeah. I think Wisconsin, Penn State has a win that Wisconsin doesn't. Wisconsin got swept by Michigan and Ohio State, and Penn State got the win over Ohio State. So
and got blanked by Michigan.
Yeah.
But I feel just because of the role that Penn State's been on since, and yeah, they won the blocked field goal, and you're going to remember that blocked field goal until the day you die, Mr. Buckeye. But that ever since they blocked that kick, they've been on such a roll. Maybe it's ever since James Franklin was inducted into the ESU Hall of Fame. It could have been one or the other. But ever since they've gotten on that roll, it doesn't look like the team's slowing down. They're a great second-half team. And you look at that game against Michigan State this past weekend. They were down 12-10 going into the locker rooms. Came out of the locker rooms. No Saquon Barkley, their best offensive player, sat down the entire game, and they beat the tar. Yeah, a Pee-wee team could beat the tar out of Michigan State this season. But
Ohio State didn't.
Way to screw me over there, Mike.
But they beat them so bad in the second half without their best offensive weapon. So you gave Barkley the rest. He's going to play against Wisconsin. I don't think they're going to be able to stop what he brings to that offense, which is going to propel Penn State into the Final Four.
I think Wisconsin will be able to stop him because Michigan State stopped him. When he scored his touchdown, he had 9 carries, 9 yards, and a touchdown. Great, great vertical leap. I mean, I don't know why that guy didn't play basketball, but I mean, I think...
He might. Their basketball team is bad.
Oh, well, watch out. They got a lot of Roman Catholic alumni on that team. Hey, now. But no, I mean, like, looking at, like, who they have... I like McSorley. I do like the receivers. I love that tight end after that catch. That was an awesome catch. But I just think that Wisconsin's defense could really put a hurting on that offense. And, I mean, Wisconsin is going to be pretty. You know what they're going to do, and I think they're one of the best at executing it. So, I mean.
Thing is, with Wisconsin, and it's been this way for, seems like, 5 years now, just if you have a run game, you could grind away at them, and eventually they let up those big ones. And obviously I saw Ohio State do it with Zeke. And I think Penn State may have that same opportunity with Barkley to do the same thing. And, you know, like I said, it'll be slow at the beginning, grind away, and then he'll take off.
Well, let me ask you this. Because, you know, as we've seen this season with college football, a curveball can be thrown at any time. You know, for example, a blocked field goal, Pitt over Michigan.
Pitt over Penn State. You want to go there?
Pitt over Penn State. Did I say a blocked field goal? So you look at a curveball can be thrown any time in college football. That's the beauty of the sport. These guys, they don't play for the money. They play for the passion. Anything can happen.
Unless they play for USC, then they're playing for the money.
That's true. But if
gotcha, if I got gotcha, you, Tim.
If Wisconsin beats Penn State, or let's just unfactor the Big Ten game right now. If Colorado, who's only number 9 in the AP poll that came out, I believe, on Sunday, if Colorado were to knock off number 4 Washington, and it's a close game in the Big Ten, said the final score is 19-17, do you put Colorado all the way up there? They beat a top 4.
No, I think if Colorado wins, you have 2 Big Ten teams in the champ in Ohio State. I think if any of the conference champions that we think are going to be the conference champions, other than Big Ten, I think Big Ten's a lock. SEC is a lock. Even if Alabama loses, I think you have to put them in because you can't hurt them for their one loss in the conference championship.
They won't go any further than 2 if they lose that game. If they win, they'll be 1. If they lose, they'd be 2.
If they lose that game, I'd say they're probably 4 because they're not a champion.
Mm-hmm.
I'd have to go if.
But see, then, not to cut you off, but if Alabama loses. It's in theory, no way Florida's holding a candle to them. You have, granted, they played in the title game.
It would.
But
be
you have one loss, Ohio State,
it would
and one
Alabama,
loss, Alabama.
Ohio State for that 4 spot, no doubt. I think they would give it to Alabama.
Oh yeah,
but I mean,
but if it's Wisconsin and Ohio State beat Wisconsin,
I think if you're a champion, you get in because the committee has shown that if you're a champion, you get in. I want to ask you, what makes this Ohio State team different from 2014 TCU, 2014 Baylor? First year of the playoff, didn't win a conference championship, and they don't make the playoff. But 4 champions did.
Yeah.
I think it's the same principle. I think it's the exact same principle because Ohio State, for all intents and purposes this year, is going to get in. And they're not even going to play. Now, there's a championship game in their conference, but they're not even going to play for it. Did they finish in 2nd or 3rd?
2nd.
2nd place. So they're not even going to play for the conference championship. Yeah. TCU, I can't remember which one. Were they co-champions that year?
Yeah, they're co-champions.
They won the conference, mm-hmm. But for the sole fact they didn't get to play each other to make one definitive winner. That's why you didn't see one of them in. And would the playoff have been better had they have gotten in? I don't think so. You had 4 really strong teams that year, but I think just the fact that they didn't have opportunity to play, but Ohio State did. And they didn't make it because of a blocked kick. I think it discredits Ohio State a little bit. Not enough, I think, to the point where they're going to be out. But I think it discredits them over 2014 TCU and Baylor.
What do you think, Lewis? Because before you even start talking, they both beat Oklahoma.
Baker wasn't there yet.
Trevor Knight.
Trevor Knight. I think it's a matter of we have the proof this season that Ohio State beat Wisconsin. And if I have to run that field goal 10 times, Penn State's only getting it once or twice. So I think that plays a factor in that. Listen, Penn State beat Wisconsin, beat Michigan, who beat Penn State. Resume and everything taken into consideration, I think they're a superior team to whoever comes out of the game Saturday between Wisconsin and Penn State. as opposed to, like you said, with TCU and Baylor, we didn't know who the better team was.
We don't know what we know that they didn't get to the championship because they didn't play each other, and we know that the two guys in there, Penn State is one of the teams in there, and they beat Ohio State. Ohio State didn't get there, and you can make all the excuses you want, but if you're not there, you're not there.
Yeah.
And that's not I don't care who you beat. You didn't make it, which means you're now the third best team at most. And I think I have a
stat. Oh, yeah, no, I don't disagree. Yeah. Third or fourth. That's
yeah.
Because we're going to fall not playing. Mm-hmm. But I don't think we fall out of the top four.
Oh, I think you do. I think you're the third best team in the Big Ten. That's what I was saying. I think looking at the rankings, I think people, you look at them, and I get it because I do it myself. A lot of people look at them and go, oh, well, they faced Michigan, who's five. But Michigan's also started up there. Colorado started from the bottom of the Pac-12, the worst team in the Pac-12, 1-11 last year, and they're all the way up to 10-2. And what if they started the season in the top 10?
Yeah.
They're probably not 9 right now. They're probably probably 6, 5 or 6, right next to Michigan. I mean, you look at, the rankings, you could say this team's that, but it's also where you started. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Iowa didn't start in the top 25, so they never had to fall out. They just kept climbing, even though they have 4 losses. Whereas a team like Houston should be in the top 25, but they're not because they started there. And when you lose...
Well, and a loss to Memphis doesn't help either.
Well, no, it doesn't. And a loss of your head coach also won't help you. But...
The same argument goes for Penn State. Is they I believe they were the bottom of the top 25 or even maybe unranked. And one win got them from, I think, 23 in the Ohio State game to, I think they were 11 out of that game.
Oh, yeah, no doubt. I mean, that just – I think you have to just wipe the entire – you just wipe it clean. And I think if I'm the committee, I don't even worry about what people are ranked. I worry about – What is it like? What's there? I think the rankings this week, and you're gonna hate me, Lewis, but the rankings this week, I would have Alabama, Clemson, Washington, then I would have probably Penn State 4, Wisconsin 5.
Like coming out tomorrow.
Yes, because 4 and 5 are gonna play each other in the Big Ten champion. One of them's gonna stay. One of them's gonna drop. That's just it. Adds a little something for the Big Ten championship. But right now, you don't know what team's going to be in there, so you have them 4 or 5. And then I would probably go Ohio State 6, and then so on from there. Just because, I mean, that's what I think the top 4 is going to be. It's going to be, I think Ohio State will probably end the season, barring no more losses to teams I think that are in front of them, will end the season 5. Just how it is. That's how I think.
And I agree with that idea of having them play, whether it's Penn State or Wisconsin, more likely Wisconsin would be in that 4 hole. But you add a little extra oomph to the Big Ten game because, yeah, it's not going to have the glitz and glamour as if Ohio State was playing it. You know, if Ohio State was playing it, it's the top thing on TV that night. But, you know, outside of the Wisconsin, every Packers fan's going to be watching it. That's about it, and you know, everybody out in Happy Valley. But if you're doing that, where you put, like I said, most likely Wisconsin 4 and then State 5, they're playing for that 4th spot. They know they win that game, they're in, and it's going to add that little boost to the players, to the fans. It's going to make the game all that much better. And but then if you're Ohio State, I agree with putting them at 6 because, yeah, they're, like you said, at best, due to what happened with Penn State and Michigan, they can finish no higher than 3rd in the Big Ten overall. So if you're Ohio State, you're watching that Washington game because if Washington loses, you push them in. But unless Colorado beats them by 50, which I don't see happening. But that's the only... I mean, it'd have to take a miracle for Colorado to be a guarantee to get in. I like the idea of Colorado getting in because, like you said, they were 1-11 last year. The idea of them getting in is nice. But like I said, Ohio State, if you're doing that, it's Wisconsin 4, Penn State 5, Ohio State 6. If you're Urban Meyer, you're watching that Washington game and praying for Colorado. Because that's the only way you're getting in at that point.
Oh, yeah, no doubt.
See, I get it from an aspect of putting emphasis on the conference championship games, but the problem I have is you're saying Ohio State's going to drop from 2-6 the Tuesday after beating the number 3 team in the nation.
Yeah, but that's just stupid. That was just stupid on college football's part. I mean, they didn't think ahead. I mean, they do. They say they rank it weekly.
Yeah.
And I think you could start looking at the who's in the conference championship, and they're not the best team in their conference. So they're not going to be the best. It's one of the top 4 teams. All right, we're going to take our break, but first, Mike, I want to hear your top 4.
As of right now, if the college playoffs started tomorrow, I would say number 1, the Alabama Crimson Tide. I'd say number 2, Clemson. Number 3, Penn State / Wisconsin, hopefully Penn State. And number 4, Ohio State.
So you have Washington missing.
I have Washington missing because a little of 2 things. I believe in Colorado. I think they're playing with that chip on their shoulder, like you said, with the winning a game last year. They want to go from worst to first. And I think that when it comes down to the brass tacks of picking who's getting in, they're going to look at how bad the rest of the Pac-12 was, where you really only had, of the 12 teams that are in it, you know, you never know with the Big 12 having 10, the Big 10 having 14, the 12 teams that are in it, there was only 4 that were somewhat decent. You had Washington and Colorado at the top of the pack, but then you had USC, who was there. They weren't fantastic.
Came on once they put in Darnold.
Yeah. And you had Washington State, who the only reason 2 years ago, I didn't even know Washington State had a good program until that coach started acting like a nut in press conferences.
Mike Leach.
Yeah.
Mike Crabtree, Texas Tech.
But right. I think that they're going to, when it comes down to the brass tacks of picking who's going to play in the Peach Bowl and who's going to play in the Fiesta Bowl, they can't put a team who won a subpar conference. Yeah, they're Power 5, but it's number 5 if you're ranking the Power 5s. You can get the winner of the SEC, get the winner of the ACC, and you can get 2 teams from the Big 10, which this year in the past 2 or 3 years has been the best conference in college football. So I don't think they're going to pass up on that opportunity to get 3 teams in there, 2 teams in the Big Ten, and then Alabama and Clemson, who all season have been the top 2 teams in the nation. So I say Alabama, Clemson, the Big Ten champion, and Ohio State.
And Lewis, who's your top 4?
I have the same thing, just flip 3 and 4.
All right. So you guys are not giving the Pac-12 as much credit as I am. I think the Pac-12 is much better. I think they probably are better than the Big Ten, to be honest. But, you know.
I think.
Hey, Lewis, we got weeks to.
Oh, yeah. No, but I think, just to close it out, I think, and I know it's not supposed to be based on this. It's supposed to be picking the best 4 teams. But if it were Stanford or USC, we're not having this argument.
It'd be a different story.
Yeah, if it were USC or Stanford or Oregon, we wouldn't be having this argument because it's a school that everybody has known last few years, opposed to Washington, who had Jake Locker and then nothing.
No doubt. Mike, thank you for calling in. We'll take our break now. We'll come back. We'll talk some MLB as they are going through a labor dispute, as the offseason really hasn't done anything because of the labor dispute possibly. Packers are moving the ball down the field.
It's not, of course.
Not what we want to see. But, we'll come back. We'll talk about that. And then we'll also try and preview some of the offseason, assuming there still will be one, as long as players don't lock out. We'll be right back. Monday Night Lights, 101.7 WDSR. Monday Night Lights, 101.7 WDSR. That wasn't the original, but I was kind of digging that one.
It was
fun. Not digging the Packers touchdown right there. Not a way to start the game off for a must-win game. And Jess beat me in pool. So look at that.
I'm about to start a game with you right now.
Yeah, look at that. I have two losses so far. Hopefully we don't get a third one with the MLB being locked out. They are ongoing talks. So far, it seems like the winter meetings are going to be missed, my favorite time of the year. And, of course, it seems as if they don't get anything done, then it might be a lockout or a strike.
Yeah.
Hopefully not. That would not be ideal. But, I mean, apparently the owners that were pushing for the international draft have backed off, I think, with the majority of the MLB being international players. It's better for them, I think, signing instead of being drafted, because it gives them more security. I'm not sure. Other things that I'm sure the qualifying offer is holding it up, but I think both sides would probably want to get rid of that. It's just some odds and ends. It should be fixed by, the deadline is December 1st. It won't be fixed by December 1st, but I would be surprised if the disputes got into February. I don't see that happening at all. It seems like both sides want it done. Both sides are kind of almost want the same thing. and just I'm sure some little odds and ends with players probably wanting more security.
Yeah.
The owners wanting to try and make the most profit, like it usually is when you have upper management and employees with labor disputes. But I mean, other than that, not really much to comment on. Do you want to comment on at all the labor disputes?
No, I haven't really been following it. So
I feel like it was. I feel like I kind of had to.
Yeah.
My dad's a big union guy. I know he always talked to me about their union disputes and what's going on with them. So I feel like it was only right that I was following this one.
Yeah.
I am a union guy. I'm a big fan. Union. Anyone who is in a union out there, keep doing your thing. It's where it's at. But let's talk about some off-season stuff and how that's kind of slowed down.
Yeah.
The talks. One deal that just broke a little less than an hour ago. The Marlins are possibly nearing a deal with Edison Volquez. That would really help them with their pitching.
Yeah.
Obviously, it was already not good. And then they lost Jose Fernandez, and now they really got to add some pitching.
And they lost Cashner on top of it.
Exactly. I mean, he wasn't doing well at all, so it was probably a good choice to let him walk. But, I mean, right now they have Tommy Kohler, Conley, Nicolino, and Chen. Four guys. Yeah. Two of them, Conley and Nicolino, bounced up and down between AAA and the majors. So getting Volquez would help. There's talk about possibly looking at C.J. Wilson. So they're going to be looking for older starters to try and
eat innings.
Exactly, and then probably give them something. They have a good bullpen. David Phelps I really like a lot. He can bounce between starting and relieving. But let's talk about some... I mean, I'm trying to think of... We really haven't looked at any team at all this year.
Yeah.
So we'll just go with the two easy teams, the Mets and the Phillies, and if we will touch on the rest of the NL East. Lewis, I know you wrote an article about
it. Yes.
So you have already been thinking about this. Obviously, we talked about the Mets getting Walker, needing to sign Cespedes, possibly moving right to first. Reyes can play third.
Yeah.
But is there any big moves in there at all?
I would say if there is a big move, it's at the back end of the pen. I think, you know, even with the domestic violence problem now with Jerry's familiar, I think it was an idea originally anyway before that news broke to pursue a Chapman or Melanson or Jansen, someone, just to lengthen that bullpen up. You know, obviously they have the good starters, but, if Harvey doesn't have it and we can get him out in the sixth inning, you know, or the fifth and go to, you know, a Gazelman and for an inning. And then, you know, if it's a close game, obviously, you know, Reed Familia, closer X, you know, just really lengthen that bullpen out, really get some guys in there to improve the team. And obviously, I think before the allegations, it may have been a, you know, go sign a, you know, quality bullpen arm, but not a closer. You know, maybe a, Greg Holland, or I don't know.
Like a guy like J.P. Howell or something.
Yeah,
like that.
Something like that, like a seventh, eighth inning guy. But I think now with, you know, just not being sure what the suspension's going to be for Familia, I think the need is there for it to be a closer.
And if Familia is able to come back this season, is that, I mean, are you okay with that? Because we saw what Familia does in tie games, in games where he's down. He has that closer mentality, which helps more than people think. I mean, he struggles in tie games. Games that aren't in the ninth inning, games that he's down a run possibly, inning saves that take longer than three outs. So it's gonna be tough. There's Paul Turner's first catch. That's exciting. Matthews. Jesus, I'm losing it. I remember Paul Turner wore the white.
It's also Matthews' first catch.
Yeah, true. First catch. But, I mean, you look at that, and is that cause for concern? Because, I mean, I know you want to be thinking if you lose them, but if you keep them, then that might be a problem.
Yeah. I think he'll be fine. I think it'll take some time.
Oh, Clay Matthews got laid out. I apologize.
It's all good. I think it'll take some time, but he did do it 2 years ago when Mejia was the closer. So, granted, he wasn't as good as he was 2 years ago, but, you know, listen, if he didn't screw up, he wouldn't be in this spot. So, I think the Mets make the move, and I think, you know, it'll come. If it doesn't come back to him right away, it'll come back to him to be able to, you know, pitch the eighth inning without the game being over if he gets out of the inning. So,
yeah, I mean, that'll be – I mean, I like the idea of getting more bullpen arms, but like I said, I mean, he's getting that mentality now. As DGB gets another big catch. He's doing good on this drive. The thing that I've been looking at for a couple years now for the Mets, and this will be last before we go to the Phils.
Yeah.
I think they got to move Matt Harvey eventually, right?
Eventually.
When is his contract up? Is he a free agent in 2019?
Yeah, in 2 years with Harper.
Okay. If you have 5 good starters this year, do you move him during the year, or are you waiting till the offseason?
Wait till the off season. I think you wait till the off season. I think, obviously, that's helped when they're going to be right in the middle of. As long as the arms stay healthy, they're going to be right in the thick of the race with Washington. I think it would come in the off season. You get more, just because, you know, every team would be interested. He's a young arm. If you trade him during the season, it's just going to be the contenders that want him. I think it would come next offseason, not during the season.
So if he is pitching...
Also, not to cut you off, but also because the Mets don't have a cologne they could go to if they were to pull the trigger on a trade like that.
So their rotation would be Harvey, Syndergaard,
DeGrom, Wheeler, Mats,
and Lugo?
Wheeler.
Well, Lugo pitched well last year, too.
They've already said that. As long as Wheeler makes it through camp without his arm falling off, he's in the rotation.
But Lugo pitched well. Gazelman also pitched well. So you have 7 possible starters. If by the All-Star break, Harvey looks like the 4th best, he might be having a good year, but compared to some of those arms, he could be the 4th best pitcher on your team.
Yeah.
If the offense is slacking, you could use Harvey to get a big-time bat.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And when you're in the postseason, you're only using 4 starters anyway. So if you're at the halfway mark and you're saying, we need to get this offense better, we have a chance to get a big-time bat for Matt Harvey, who we're probably going to move this offseason anyway.
Yeah.
Then do you do it?
Well, if that was the case, then yes. But I think, you know, if the Mets are just going to get more prospects to develop and continue to be cheap, then he would get moved during the off season, next off season.
All right, good. Because I think if they move him, it would be for a major league bat anyway.
Yeah.
I mean,
very similar to Lester for Cespedes a couple years ago.
Yeah. So I could even see like a Harvey for Jackie Bradley Jr. or someone like that. Because that's the first team I thought of, because I was reading a lot of Chris Sale rumors.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I think that's something they have to look into, and it may be – I mean, if they could do it now, I'd do it. I'm not sure because
of the injury.
Exactly. Yeah. He's going to have to show a little, but
– Did the Eagles score there?
Yeah, Wentz ran it in. I think they should probably do it as soon as possible. If it's a good deal, do it.
Yeah.
I mean, if the White Sox are thinking about moving Sale – and they do decide to move him, and then they come to the Mets, and they go, all right, Frazier for Harvey. Right now.
If they threw another prospect, then I would do it. Only because Frazier only has 1 year left on his deal.
But Harvey's got the injury history. I don't want to waste. I could be giving up a 40 home run guy, good fielder.
Yeah.
For a guy with injury history, I don't know if Harvey's ever going to pan out.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I see where you're coming from, but
I'm Rick Hahn. I'm Sandy Alderson.
Yeah.
I mean, we're on the phone right now. I'm saying, listen, you're lucky I'm not asking you for a prospect in the deal because
yeah,
how's Harvey going to turn out? Like, I should be asking for Montero as well because he ain't cracking the staff anytime soon. And you don't know what he's going to become, but it gives me a insurance policy. But I'm not because I want to help you out as much as this could possibly help me out. I'm giving you 30 seconds to respond. Harvey for Frazier.
Done.
All right, there it is. That's what I think that.
I mean, it comes down to I've already set my mindset on what I want long term. Mm-hmm. I think the Mets are going to be able to keep three of those arms around, and I think Harvey and Wheeler are the odd men out there. I think, you know, Thor's too young compared to the rest of them and throws too hard. Keep him around. Keep Matt because he's a lefty. Keep DeGrom. He's a little older. So it might be one big contract as opposed to a Harvey, which could be two big contracts. And obviously, DeGrom doesn't have his head up his ass, so like Harvey does. So,
I mean,
I've set my mind. Those are the three that like I want the Mets to keep. Mm-hmm. So,
all right, cool. I just wanted to get that out of you because I know you always hesitate it, and I figured I could get you out of it with that. We'll just touch on the Phils for last 8 minutes here. They got Howie Kendrick in a deal that gave up Darnell Sweeney, who we got in the Utley trade. He really didn't do anything. The only good thing he did was help me get a favorite on one of my tweets from Jason Stark because Darnell Sweeney filled in for Chase Utley, was traded for Chase Utley, and in his first home run was a pinch hit home run, whereas the same thing was for Chase Utley. So that helped me get a favorite. Other than that, really didn't show anything. Darren Ruff, we don't got any room for him anymore. We'll see what he can do with LA. I mean, he may get some chances if there's injuries, but I sure he'll just play in AAA. He might not even make the roster.
Yeah.
There's talk of possibly a guy like Brian Dozier coming to the Phils in a trade, 40 home run player. He hit 268. He's a good defender. He's 29. He's on a team-friendly deal. I think he's only getting paid $9 million for the next 2 years, maybe. And there's talk of the Phillies possibly getting him. And I wouldn't hate it. I mean, you look at what the outfield could be next year if it's going to be – it's Kendrick and left as of right now. And then you have Herrera and Quinn possibly. I mean, I think you get a guy like Dozier. I mean, if you give up like Hernandez and Herrera,
yeah.
I mean, it seems like people are kind of turning on Herrera. You put Quinn in center. You let the second base prospects in Valentin and Kingery. They continue to develop. You maybe sign a guy in right field, or you go with Altair.
Or call up Nick.
Yeah, or call up Nick Williams, but I still think he needs at least half a season in AAA still. I mean, I don't hate that. You have Rupp, Joseph, Dozier, Galvis, Franco, then Kendrick, Quinn, Altair. Or possibly a free agent signing, and Altair is your fourth outfielder.
Yeah.
I mean, people are talking about not rushing the rebuild and all, but like, I mean, we didn't see anything out of Cesar Hernandez until this year.
Yeah.
I mean, he was a nice player. He was fast. He was good. He was a decent defender.
Just the process.
I mean, at this point, I would just be like, all right, max out. I'm like, we maxed out on Ken Giles.
Yeah.
I mean, Herrera, I think Quinn's a better center fielder. I think Quinn could end up being a better player. I think I would do that deal.
Yeah.
But There's a lot of talk about Dozier. Do you think he is a possibility for the Phillies, or do you think he's going somewhere else?
I think he's a possibility just because it would give you that veteran to kind of center the rebuild around. Not that he's old, but he's... But I think if he played any other position, absolutely, I could see it. But being a big-time offensive guy at second base, which you just don't see a lot of big offensive guys, you know, you have Cano, you have him, you have Pedroia, you know, just Kipnis, and then you start picking at straws a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Murphy.
I'd even put Murphy ahead of Kipnis.
Yeah. You know, you start picking at straws a bit after the you know, top five or six second basemen. So I think the price may get driven up by a team that just needs a second baseman. Be it, you know. And, I mean, it would be a contender. Because obviously a contender is going to go for that kind of offense at second base. But, I mean, I could see it being a possibility. I could just see another team like... trying to think. The... The Blue Jays... The Orioles, I mean, Scope's okay, but I mean, he's no Dozier. Just a team that is in it and can use that extra offense to get them either back to where they were or over the hump. I just think a contending team would give up way more for a second baseman that can hit, you know, 30 home runs in the rec park.
Yeah, and I think, but I think the Phillies could still give more if they wanted to. I mean, I don't know. I think the Phillies have the best place for him. He would actually have hit more home runs in Citizens Bank Park last year because the left field wall is actually closer. I mean, I don't know. I wouldn't hate them doing that. I mean, throwing a guy like Mark Appel.
Yeah.
At that point, I mean, we have a good number of arms that I'm not too worried about. I would like that. I think it would bring some offense. I think it would, because, again, you don't know what these young kids are going to be. You add a guy who's cheap, not signed for long, can add some power, because that was, I mean, you didn't have any middle of the lineup last year. And I think if you did, you could have had better success towards in the beginning of the season, when we looked like we possibly could be doing something, and then towards the end of the season.
Yeah.
I think the arms will be good. I mean, I don't see why not. What do you got to lose? I mean,
yeah.
Like I said, you're trading guys that you already are exploring trades for anyway.
Yeah.
But then again, it's like, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. But I don't know. I just don't see – you need some power, and I don't really see Cesar or Herrera giving it. Herrera's swing is just – not a top of the order swing. He does hit a lot. He does hit close to 300, but he also swings and misses a lot.
Yeah.
I would like to see Quinn up there, but we'll see how that goes. We'll see how the rest of the offseason goes. We'll see what the labor relations. We'll see how the game finishes up. The Eagles defense can't stop a nosebleed right now, so that's not good. I mean, the whole point was just, hey, get us a couple stops. We can move the ball in this defense, but I will see how the game continues to go. Yeah, oh, there's Randall Cobb muscling for a first down because he's the biggest guy on the field. But thank you for listening to Monday Night Lights again this week. We will be back here next week. We'll have more Christmas music because we know you all love Christmas music. And it'll be December next time we're back.
Yeah.
And then the NFL season will actually start to heat up. We're going to have – that's when the contenders start to show themselves. So we will see. And we will see how the rest of this game goes. So go Birds.
Go Pack, go.
Yeah. We'll be back here next week on Monday Lights. Thanks for listening, everyone.
You're listening.